Hello wonderful person, this is Anton, and in this video we're going to be talking about a somewhat inspirational story that has more to do with what some people are capable of than it does with the actual discovery itself. In this video we're going to talk about one of these wonderful people that you see on the screen here, and the exciting discovery that he was able to make very recently by writing this paper. Let's talk about this and welcome to What the Math. So sometimes I actually take a look at who's watching my videos, and I notice that I have a few visitors and a few viewers that are in their 60s and in their 70s. And sometimes it makes me wonder, what do those people do? Are they retired? Are they grandmas and grandpas? Or are they still very active in their sort of professional life? And it makes me really hopeful that I'm still very active and very curious in my 60s and my 70s, and hopefully I'm still doing a lot of educational and possibly even productive stuff. Which is why I was really excited to read the story of this wonderful person. This here is Alan Lawrence, and even though I don't know him, I sort of wish I did, because this wonderful person, after retiring from his original career as an engineer and as a consultant, decided to enroll back into this university when he was in his 60s. This was back in 2011. Now, he also graduated and then decided to pursue his biggest passion, which was astronomy. Apparently, he always loved carrying around telescope and has been observing galaxies for many years, but he wanted to take this to the next level. So, in 2018, he enrolled in graduate studies and began pursuing his dream of becoming an actual astronomer. And very recently, only a few days ago, he published his first paper. And he's also the main author of this paper, with three other professors as co-authors. And to me, this is just pure inspiration. A 77-year-old retired engineer decides to pursue his dream and become a full-fledged astronomer, possibly in his 80s. How cool is that? But enough about him, let's talk about what he's discovered. So this is in regards to a galaxy, or technically two galaxies, that you can see right here, known as ARP-269. The galaxy number one is here, the second one is here. And we've been looking at these two galaxies for a very long time, so we've collected quite a lot of different images in different frequencies, including infrared, X-ray, and so on. We've seen at least two supernovae here. The most recent one was in 2008, and so they are actually pretty well known to us. In other words, it seems like there was very little to discover here. However, according to Alan, he's been always looking at this galaxy using his own telescope and did collect a few of his own images, and something didn't really add up. There appeared to be two different sources of a lot of energy in the center. And I'm not really talking about this galaxy and this galaxy. I mean, in the main galaxy, there appeared to be two different major components to it. We usually refer to these as galactic nuclei, and it just so happens that he was completely correct. And so by looking at this galaxy in a lot of different spectra, including visual light and infrared light, he discovered that inside of it, there appeared to be two different nuclei, the so-called galactic nuclei. One of them was only visible in infrared, and one of them was only visible in visual light. This is the one that he already observed with his own telescope. And then he also discovered two more regions, A and B, which are so-called H2 regions, also known as hydrogen clouds, such as, for example, the very famous nebula that we refer to as Orion Nebula, where many different stars are created very quickly. We also usually call these regions starburst region. But these starburst regions are not as exciting as this discovery right here. And this could suggest many things. One of those things is that, well, this is actually a result of a collision between two galaxies, which means that inside of this galaxy there already is a composition of two different objects. And then the third galaxy here is also going to be joining them relatively soon. So not only is this a binary nuclei galaxy, it could eventually become a triple nuclei galaxy. And these galaxies are generally pretty rare. Now, normally we can see double nuclei galaxies very easy if they're active, so-called active galactic nuclei, where the black hole in the middle is absorbing so much mass that it's producing a ridiculous amount of energy and creates a very bright spot in the night skies. But this is not the case here. Instead of seeing any kind of a black hole interaction, we're just seeing the nuclei themselves. In other words, what we're seeing is somewhat equivalent to this bright central region in our own galaxy, the Milky Way. So we know that some of these regions don't actually necessarily have black holes in them. The best example of such a region is a galaxy I've talked about previously, the nearby Triangulum galaxy. which is one of our neighbors, and it's relatively close to the Andromeda galaxy as well. And here in the middle, even though the nucleus itself is quite well visible, it doesn't possess any black hole in the middle. So it's quite possible that these two regions are also black hole free, although it could also be just very inactive quiet black holes as well. So for now, we don't really know what's in these regions. We just know that it's a result of very likely two galactic collisions. In other words, something very similar to what you're observing on the screen may have occurred several billion years ago, possibly several hundred million years ago, and created the major galaxy now known as NGC 4490. This here is known as NGC 4485. And altogether, these two galaxies are known as ARP 269. And that's pretty much it for the discovery itself, but it's really not the discovery that I wanted to talk about, but the discoverer himself. Because to me, it's just so inspirational to hear that someone does not stop, I guess in some sense, dreaming and decides to take it to the next level. Taking your hobby and then turning it into a career and a profession and actual academic study is just something that I personally really admire. I really hope that I continue doing the same, and when I'm in my 60s and my 70s, I too possibly do something similar. And since my hobby is, Legos? Maybe I'll become a Lego engineer. Okay, that's a bit of a joke. Note to self, don't make jokes on the channel. Either way though, I really wish Alan all of the best. I hope he continues discovering new things, and I really hope he actually gets his PhD and becomes possibly the oldest PhD graduate ever. Although I'm sure someone else will beat him eventually. But anyway, on that note, well, what we can learn from this is that we really shouldn't give up on our dreams and continue pursuing them and eventually find a way to make them into something we can actually enjoy doing. A very inspirational story. You can check out more about this in the description below. On that note though, that's really it. Thank you for watching, come back tomorrow to learn something else. Space out, and as always, bye bye. Oh, and maybe consider supporting the channel on Patreon. It does help me quite a lot.